So welcome back. So we were left with sleeplessness, but I hope you are not left with sleeplessness. And we are all talking about the effectiveness of yoga on to our insomnia problems. So based on which we try to see some research, and I hope you remember what we said last week. I'll also recover in the future contents or future slides as such. So as you can see, when it comes to practicality, how well are we able to keep ourselves awake and how we are able to keep ourselves into sleep is a question of which is not in our control. So that is the reason why yoga pitches in, because anything which is not into control, yoga knows how to control it. Okay, so that is the reason why we need to see this in aspects of how practicality and how yoga has an effect on the body and mind. So there are many research papers which says that yoga reduces or decreases the insomnia prevalence in postmenopausal women because it reduces the cognitive arousal. When we say cognitive arousal is you are thinking, that is arousal. So you are trying to do things in your mind, that reduces because you are more focused onto your job. So you don't get yourself into, you know, different kinds of mentalities. You just keep yourself very much focused. And because of this, there is a deregulation of HPA axis. So HPA is hypothalamo, pituitary and adrenal axis. So this is very much responsible for your inducing your stress, inducing the alertness and vigilance. So yoga not just creates the alertness and balance, it also deregulates the same axis. So again, you're trying to get into your body, get into your system and trying to control the way you want it. So because of which, once you start controlling your HPA axis, you know, the body's master clock, that is circadian rhythm, is also under your control. So this is the reason why we believe yoga is a one kind of a behavioral non-photosynthesizer, because on your observation, on your way of doing things, on your way of taking care of your body, slowly your body is more receptive. It becomes kind of more under the rule of how you want it. So that is the reason why yoga has a lot of implications on not just your sleep pattern, it has an implication on all the patterns, all the ways how your body can be controlled. So as I said last time, exercise is very good for your body. Exercise triggers something called as interleukin-6. This is a kind of a, immunity booster, immunity enhancer. So that resembles and that increases the interleukin 10 and interleukin 8. Because of this, there is a good cardiopulmonary and muscular functions, which has been overwhelmingly projected. This aids in sleep time, which is totally in nature. This also pushes you more to the deep state, that is the beta states and the delta states of your sleep. The same time, this reduces the time taken to sleep, that is sleep onset is faster. The same time, latency of sleep. So you have a good deep sleep, and that enhances your quality of life. So that is very important. So the next day when you get up afresh, that is because you had done a really good workout. So that is the reason why we generally say, you know, this body is a mechanical engine. So you stop eating, then we can talk indifferently. But the problem is we keep on eating. So body needs somehow to shed off these excess of food which you have taken. So that is the reason why you go for an exercise, you do some physical activity, which is a little bit of sweatiness, which induces a little bit of tiredness in your body, and there's a lot of changes. Your immunity enhances and your sleep enhances and your focus and ability also enhances. So if you can even control your exercise regime by doing yoga, it also enhances the other aspects of your body as well. So now, like I said last time, let's try to reason out why you don't need sleep inhibitors. Sleep inhibitors are nothing similar to that of any of the other foods and stuff like coffee, like tea. You know, you give 5 mg of alprazolam, which is the sleep inducing drug. If you are on that for probably 1 or 1.5 months, then 5 mg is not enough. So you have to go for a different medications, or you have to increase the dose of it. So that is the reason why sleep inhibitors are not good on a long run. So disciplining in sleeping time, like I said last time, discipline itself is yoga. So you do not see, you don't eat disciplinedly, you have diabetes or obesity. At the same time, you don't go to your bed and wake up disciplinedly. or you are not disciplined enough to sleep, or you're not disciplined enough to eat, you have problems and complications. That is the reason why it comes under yoga. So no phones or no ebooks. There are a lot of researches which talks about why looking at a phone and going to sleep can make sure that your eyes are troubled and you have something called as irritation of eyes, and that also leads to a lot of photosensitivity, and that keeps you awake. So like I said in a few slides behind or in my few previous talk, that your body is, and yoga is something which has to do with the biosynthesis of your body, which checks on to the color, which checks on to the light. Yoga reduces it. So consciously you can do it by removing some kind of a stimulants like that of phones and ebooks. Caffeine before the bed, food before the bed is a wrong thing. So why just rule out caffeine? Don't eat anything at least after the sun sets. That's what yoga says, or that's what even Ayurveda says. So if you don't eat anything, body will try to adjust itself and give you a better relaxation. It doesn't grumble, it doesn't speak out much, at the same time it doesn't growl. So you relax, your body relaxes. So as I said, regular exercise is a must, and maintain bedroom ethics. And maintain bedroom ethics is also music to relax and temperature. Like I said, consciously you're creating an atmosphere for the body, for the mind, to make sure that you are doing what is supposed to be done. Similarly, bed is equal to sleep. Don't sit on your bed and do work from home. You're looking at this video, don't do it on your bedrooms. You can do it in your living room, you can do it in your kitchen, or you can do it in your tables, but not in the bed. Because if you keep bed only for sleeping, then your mind is going to understand that when you're approaching to sleep, you are supposed to be in bed. So you're training your mind. So once you start training to the mind, once you start training to your body, then slowly these things comes in a long run. So at the same time, I said biocognitive way of listening to your body is by writing it down and telling that you have done a good job. You're telling your body that something is going to happen good for you. At the same time, you make sure that once you write down, you're more conscious about doing it in the next day as well. So let's say you have not done something today, so it doesn't get out of your mind. You look at the diary, you remember that you have to do something in the next day. That keeps in the mind and that reduces the stress. So this is something called what we call as cognitive behavioral therapy. So we try to take actions for your wrongdoings or your rightdoings. So there is very one thing which is very interesting is in the same yogic way of understanding, there is something called as meditation. So many people have you been doing meditation. There is a research paper which says that adequate amount of meditation can also reduce the sleep hours. Sleep is important, I am not denying the fact, but at the same time, how many hours of sleep is also a big question. Throughout my slide, I never answered this question. The reason why I never answered this question is one, for each individual, there is his activity, his lifestyle, and based on that, he sleeps. Your body is the right decision maker for your sleep. As you age by, let's say children at the age of 2 to 15, they sleep really good because they're not really worried about anything tomorrow. They're not worried about what they have done. They probably are worried only for the exams, or even the younger kids, like at the age of 4, they're not even worried about these things. So they have a very good sleep quality. At the same time, they are very active. They rush here and there. Once they get anything, they pull out all those things. This is accepted. But at the same time, once you start going to work and once you have family to develop and you have family responsibilities and you have company responsibilities and all those things, slowly when you get yourself dwindled in the responsibilities, your sleep pattern also comes down. So your performance is indirectly proportional to your sleep. So that is the reason why we cannot give a time frame telling that this is how you must sleep or this is the amount at which you should sleep. Study says that an adult needs at least 7 to 8 hours of a sleep. But what is the quality of sleep? That is also very important. You go to bed, you just roll around in the bed and you wake up. That even if you are here for 10 hours on the bed, that is not going to achieve anything. So that is the reason why, you know, I generally don't tell what exactly should be your sleep pattern. But if you could do everything in disciplined way, if you prioritize your thing accordingly, then obviously sleep will also happen at the same time. So because of the temperature outside, you feel like, you know, sleeping more. If it is too warm, you don't feel like sleeping more. So there are many factors which tells about what exactly should be the timing of your sleep. So if you really don't want to sleep, let's say majority of the viewers which I have, which the analytics or YouTube analytics shows that majority of you guys are in the earlier age of 20 to maximum age of 40, 50. And there are certain people who are also at the age of more than 60. So the first thing is these both are the younger generation and the older generation, they have a lot of differences. Older generation will not get sleep because the way their body is utilizing, because there is no physical activity, there is no mental activity, slowly their sleep is also coming down. The same time, younger generation, they have a lot of tensions, they have a lot of promises, they have a lot of responsibilities, they don't get sleep. So that is the reason why we have to keep these two in a different ways, and then we have to check this out. So for both of them, meditation is always good, because young generation, if they start doing meditation, they can prioritize their things, they get discipline in their body, they get discipline in their mind, and once that happens, then slowly everything falls in perspective. So because of that, you don't need to worry about how well is your sleep. Second, the old age, you don't have anything now. Your kids are married, your grandchildren are very well placed and they're doing well. So don't worry about them. You have done, you have lived a righteous life and you have done really good things in your life. So now don't worry about them. But very important is make sure that now you work on yourself by doing some kind of a meditation. So what happens is there is a research paper which says that if you could do it for probably 20 minutes of a meditation, you get the so-called 2 hours of a sleep. So your body is, or your mind is consciously transforming from alpha wave to delta wave. Delta wave is something which we call it as a deep sleep, where you're not aware of your body, where you don't know where you are, where you don't know who is sleeping besides you, and you don't know where you basically are sleeping. So you're just going to sleep. At the same time, this was an ancient practice. Many people, they practiced meditation and they could avoid sleep. Not just that, if you could take down to any of the ancient researchers like Isaac Newton, probably he was daydreaming or he was in a partial sleep, but he was very much focused on to his thoughts of gravity and whatnot. So as soon as an apple fell, he could attain that and he could say that this is because of gravity. Archimedes, half sleep in his water tub, he felt the lift from the water and then he discovered buoyancy. Niels Bohr, he was also got his idea of the atomic structure in his dream. The same time, Einstein could gather many of his informations to theory of light and the speed of light through his sleep. So majority of the scientists, this is the modern scientist. So obviously India is blessed with a lot of ancient scientists. Charvaka, we have Sushruta, we have Aryabhatta, and who not? If you see everybody, they are all were meditating. So basically, if you try meditating, your body, your mind gets focused onto one thing and it becomes easier for you to generate answers. This is for the people who are in their early 50s. For older 50s, the entire world is now yours. So you do not focus on anything, you can focus on everything around you. So you have to question this, like, is your sleep necessary? Or is your focus of mind necessary? So how do you get your mind focused onto things? Meditation is the answer. So even though if you're not getting sleep because of a lot of other issues, try meditating. That will aid more answers. So what happens is sometimes we are not worried about it. Sometimes we are not, our thoughts are not anxious for us, but we are still somewhere searching for some kind of a relief from our thoughts. So that is nothing but meditation. So once you start doing these kind of practices in yoga, once you start developing a generous way of getting into yoga, obviously we will get a lot of other good impressions of the mind that will create a good ambience for our mind to form and function its work. So probably think about it if you really want to sleep long or if you would like to meditate long. So yes, this was what we would like to tell at the end of the night. Sleep tight. Hope you get a good sleep. If you're not getting good sleep, hope you do good meditative techniques so that it can enhance you. So keep subscribing for such educative content that encourages me to give more and more of information and insights on yoga. So share with your friends who have trouble sleeping. And also we'll be coming up with a lot of other intrigue topics, something like yoga and its negativity. Obviously, a coin has a heads and a tail. So if there is good of yoga, there is bad of yoga. But only thing is, what are those bads? We'll try to focus on that. According to yoga, there is nothing called as bad, but we'll still try to dwell into what exactly the negative effects of yoga are. And we'll try to understand how we can do something called as Garbha Samskara, what it is, how well we have to take care of the future generation, what is its importance and how significant it is in the scientific world. At the same time, we'll try to understand the spirituality and basis of yoga and science behind it, and many much topics. So you keep encouraging me with a lot of likes and a lot of subscriptions. That encourages me to do more and more stuffs like this. Thank you for holding on, and we'll see you next week. See you later. Thank you.